All right. What seems to be the problem?
Things are terrible. Corporate profits have been negative for 3 years. Net private investment is negative. There's been a stock market crash.
Okay. Sounds like depression.
Real GNP per capita is down 30% in just 4 years. Unemployment is at 25%. In some places, it's even worse.
Ah, okay. So this isn't just depression. This is the Great Depression.
The Great Depression?
Yes, the Great Depression. Yes, it's the worst economic disaster in American history. But we had FDR. We had the New Deal. That ship was righted. And America ends up becoming the economic superpower we all know and love today.
No, that's not true at all. The Great Depression persisted all throughout the 1930s. On the eve of World War II, unemployment was nearly 20%, even after all the New Deal programs. And it wound up being the longest downturn in American history, not in spite of the government's involvement, but because of it. Let's start with something basic, like, you know, food. When FDR came into office, he's got this tremendous agricultural bounty, and because of all this food, prices on food keep falling.
Wait, you're telling me it's a problem during a depression that food has become cheap?
I don't think it's a problem, but FDR did, because for the farmer, it's not good for prices to fall. So FDR's Agricultural Adjustment Act paid farmers to cut back on production or even to produce nothing at all. Less food means higher prices, so he paid farmers to destroy a huge amount of crops in order to raise prices to make farmers better off. So 6 million pigs were slaughtered. 10 million acres of cotton were destroyed.
This sounds like a good idea, not the way you're spinning it. Because the government comes, it slaughters pigs from my farm, I'm the farmer, I get paid for the pigs, and then that meat, that pork, goes to feed poor people.
No, the pork gets destroyed. The cotton gets destroyed. All this stuff got destroyed to pull it off the market and raise prices, not give it to poor people. Mules were actually employed to destroy cotton. They actually had mules stomp on the cotton. And at first they hesitated to do it because this is not what a mule normally does. They had to be forced to do it. The whole New Deal was about helping one group and then another group and then another group, even though each time you help that one group, you're harming everybody else. And it turns out you didn't even help the farmers because other New Deal programs were even more successful driving up other prices, namely the prices of everything farmers buy.
Yeah, but if prices are collapsing all around you for years, at a certain point, you want to mitigate that damage.
But prices had been falling for about a century in American history, and the United States had become, during that time, the great industrial power of the world. So it's actually not a bad thing for prices to fall. And to the contrary, it's much worse to force them up by giving businesses the power to collude with each other so that all throughout an industry, nobody's allowed to sell below a particular price.
Okay, so that's just for food. But the New Deal is about the whole nation and the whole economy recovering. So yeah, some people are going to be negatively affected, but Americans had to make sacrifices in the hardest of times.
It wasn't just for food. What I described was actually the thinking behind the National Industrial Recovery Act. And it worked more or less the same, making it harder for the poor to buy food, to get transportation, to be clothed and housed. The National Recovery Administration allowed businesses in each industry to establish a code of production, which would set working hours, wages, and prices.
So what's wrong with that?
It means that upstarts can't compete on price. The biggest businesses tend to prosper because if you're, say, a Goodyear tire, well, everybody already knows Goodyear tire. But if I'm Tom's tire, what's the only way I can compete with Goodyear tire? Not on name recognition, but on price. But now I can't sell at a lower price because under the National Recovery Act, the government won't let me.
So FDR said the only thing we have to fear is fear itself. But a generation, the fear had been that big business monopolies in a certain industry are all going to get together and they're going to collude to jack up the prices and basically screw the population out of as much money as they can get away with. This was the nightmare concern of having an oligarchic system, that people are going to be at the mercy of these big trusts. And now they're codifying it into law?
That's pretty much the case. The very thing we were taught to fear was now mandated by law.
I still think that under extreme situations, maybe you have to rely on big companies and rely on stable prices in order to make sure to cut down on that sky-high unemployment and make sure everyone has a job. That's the problem that needs to be solved.
A lot of people think of things like the Works Progress Administration when they think about the New Deal that gave people jobs. If we look at the work of economists John Joseph Wallace and Daniel Benjamin, they found that the jobs created by the WPA and the other New Deal spending programs either just displaced private sector jobs that existed already or actually destroyed those jobs because these programs just dried up capital that could have been used for private sector investment. And we now know, because of historian Bob Higgs, that business at the time really held off from investing because they didn't know what the federal government was going to do next, and nobody wanted to expose himself to an unpredictable federal government, so they just bided their time, and meanwhile the economy continued to suffer. What it boils down to is there were a lot of programs, but they all shared the same basic flaw, that a group of experts are going to direct resources better than you and I can.
It sounds like what you're saying is there's lots of different symptoms, but they're all being treated with the same medicine, medicine that hasn't been shown to be effective in any single specific instance. So instead of focusing on treating symptoms, let's focus on preventative measures. If you have an economy based on capitalism, you inevitably have these depressions. They happen cyclically. So maybe the New Deal couldn't fix the situation because all those programs were just band-aids that didn't address the real cause.
It's very easy and fashionable to say that, but actually depressions are not a natural feature of capitalism. This or that sector may go up and down, but system-wide collapses are foreign to capitalism without government intervention. Think of it this way. Imagine a master builder who has a blueprint to build a house, but he doesn't have enough resources to build the house that the blueprint calls for. So the longer he persists in working on it, the more resources and labor hours he wastes, because the project will eventually have to be abandoned for lack of materials. The sooner he spots his error, the better. This is what happens with the economy as a whole when the Federal Reserve pushes interest rates down artificially. It gives entrepreneurs the idea that there are more resources available than there really are. The economy becomes too ambitious, embarking on long-term projects for which the necessary resources do not exist. We obviously don't want fiscal or monetary stimulus at a time like that, because that just encourages entrepreneurs to continue along this unsustainable path, rather than making them realize they need to abandon it and shift resources into more appropriate channels.
Wait a minute, so you're saying it's like taking an energy drink and you're running around on that artificial high, but if you try to nourish yourself entirely on energy drinks with nothing else, you're going to crash and you're going to collapse.
And that's what happened in the 1920s under Herbert Hoover, leading up to the stock market crash. And one of the first things Hoover did was convene a meeting of big business leaders and urge them to keep wages stable, even at a time when prices are falling. To keep wages stable, you're basically trying to give everybody a raise during the worst economic downturn in American history. Not the best time for a raise, really.
Right, because the businesses can barely afford to keep the workers they have at those wages that they're paying them when the prices are falling through the floor. So at a certain point, if those wages are kept high enough, everyone's going to lose their job because the business is going to go out of business.
That's exactly right. And by the way, contrary to what most people have been told, Hoover did not sit on his hands. He had no problem spending money. He spent more on public works projects in 4 years than had been spent in the previous 20. His Reconstruction Finance Corporation gave emergency low-interest loans to failing businesses and then began to bail out the states, helping them pay for unemployment relief, fund public works projects, etc. And then let's talk taxes. The Smoot-Hawley tariff introduced tariffs, that is, taxes on imported goods, on over 20,000 products. And the idea was to have these taxes be so high that nobody in his right mind would pay them. Instead of buying a foreign product with these ridiculous taxes on them, you would just buy the American product, which could therefore be raised in price because you have nowhere else to go. Now, this disrupted international trade and hurt Americans because American trading partners retaliated when their products were basically shut out of U.S. markets. The Italian government doubled its tariffs on American cars in response to what the U.S. was doing to them. So American automobile sales in Italy fell by 90%. And then, just as the Depression is getting really bad, Hoover took the top marginal income tax rate and raised it from 25 to 63%. And then corporate taxes go up, estate taxes go up, gift taxes go up, as do taxes on cars, tires, gasoline, toiletries, electric energy, luxury items, bank checks, and even telephone, telegraph, and radio messages. So I might point out that at the time, his opponent in the 1932 election, Franklin Roosevelt, and Roosevelt's vice presidential nominee, Jack Garner, were criticizing him for this. Garner said Hoover is leading the country down the road to socialism. And Franklin Roosevelt himself didn't say, if only Hoover would spend more money. He called Hoover's the greatest spending administration in peacetime in all our history. So not exactly what you learned in the seventh grade textbook.
Fine. I'll grant you that this was caused by government intervention in the economy and the currency far before FDR. And I'll grant you that the New Deal didn't stop the Great Depression, but FDR's president, when World War II comes along, and that's what finally got us out of the Depression and got everyone under full employment.
People say World War II got the United States out of the Great Depression. Almost everybody thinks this, or at least thought it, until historian Bob Higgs came along and forced people to recognize the absurdities that are buried in this. It's true that if you take 22% of the labor force, 11 million people, conscript them into the army, unemployment goes down. Presumably, I don't need to draw you a diagram about that. But a healthy economy does not need to take 11 million people and risk having them all die.
The problem with any kind of economic data is that you need to analyze it to understand what it's saying. So something may be factual, but it may not necessarily be truthful. So yes, it is factual that sending all the unemployed people overseas to war produced a drop in the unemployment rate. And it's factual that they're given food and clothing and shelter and helmets and guns, and in one sense, they're better off. But it's not truthful to say that if your entire job consists of 24/7 being worried about having the Nazis kill you, that this can be considered normal employment.
This has nothing to do with whether or not you think World War II was a good idea. The question is, what were its economic effects? Does it lift the country out of the Great Depression? No, it doesn't. If war spending really made a country wealthy, then today maybe the U.S. and Japan should do the following. Each of us should build the most spectacular naval fleet in history, an enormous armada of gigantic, powerful, technologically advanced ships. Then these two fleets should meet in the Pacific. Now, obviously, we don't want to kill anybody, so we'll take all the naval personnel off and evacuate them. And at that point, the U.S. and Japan would sink each other's fleets. And then we could all celebrate how much richer we'd made ourselves by devoting labor, steel, and all these other inputs to producing things that would wind up at the bottom of the ocean.
So if none of these programs and war ended up stopping the Great Depression, what are we supposed to do the next time the economy takes a downturn? Sit in our hands and do nothing?
Well, pretty much yes. We've had this experience before. The Forgotten Depression of 1920 to 21, that was a downturn that in some ways was every bit as bad as the Great Depression. And yet by the time the hapless Warren Harding, I hate to call him that, he's a good guy, by the time it occurred to him to do anything about it, it was already over. Once the dislocations of World War II were behind us, and once it became clear that the federal government was not going to engage in any more ambitious reconstructions of America, investment resumed. Business came back out from hiding, and prosperity returned.
So when people talk about the Green New Deal, it's not new at all. They're invoking programs and principles that have been put into practice almost 100 years ago, and programs and practices that often had very negative effects, sometimes even intentionally. A lot of people complain about they want to take us back to the 50s. Well, why would they want to take us back to the 30s?
That's why this stuff matters even today, because as you can see, a lot of people still draw inspiration from the New Deal. And it's what inspires a lot of really, really damaging ideas and policies today.
Wait. If you know all this stuff, Mr. Smarty Pants, why are you in here with me?
I'm not in here with you. You're in here with me.